Good morning, classmates. Good morning, Sir Jeff. Our speaker for today is the Vice President for Nestle Philippines Incorporated, Head of Tax of the Nestle Groups of Companies, a CPA lawyer by profession. She graduated at the Ateneo Law School and passed the Philippine Bar Exam in 1993. She started her career as a tax lawyer with Sisip Gores Velayo in 1998. And prior to Nestle, she was a regional tax director for Asia. I'd like to introduce our attorney, Arnie Abrams.
Great opportunity for me to address a group of students. This is the first time that I have given a presentation to high school students. I'm used to giving tax presentations to tax professionals, employees in the company. But the first time that I've given a presentation to students. Hopefully, this will be my career after that. Actually, the group has provided me with the questions yesterday. So, just to fast-track everything, I prepared a short presentation. So, the first question that they have given is, how much can tax affect companies? So, just to provide you with a brief insight about taxation in the Philippines, two departments of the Philippine government are actually implementing the tax laws. This is the Department of Finance and the Department of Local Government, both under the executive branch. Okay? The BAR, the Bureau of Customs, are actually the main agencies which implements the tax laws. Okay? So just to give, going back to the question, how much the taxes impact the business? Okay? It depends on who shoulders the tax cost. Okay? For income tax, it is shouldered by the company. The current rate right now is minimum of 2% based on gross income or 30% based on net income. So can you imagine 30%? Your net income will actually go to the government. For value-added taxes, this is a form of sales tax imposed on your gross sales, sales of goods and services, and this can be actually passed on to the customer. So this will not be shouldered by the company, provided all the supporting documents are properly documented or are in order. Okay? Document tariff stamp tax can be negotiated. Okay, VAT, the value-added tax is actually at the rate of 12%. Okay. Documentary stamp tax can be negotiated with vendors, and this can be passed on. Excise tax. Excise tax is actually part of the cost of the company, but it can be passed on to the consumer. So out of the main or the national taxes, only income tax will form part, will be shouldered by the company and cannot be passed on to the customers. Okay? So excise tax, various rates depending on the product. Okay, Bureau of Customs, for all importation of goods, rates ranges from 1 to 20% depending on the goods being imported. Local government units, or the entity which executes all the local government taxes, these are the taxes that a company or a businessman pays to the city mayors, to the provinces, to the municipal mayors. This is part of the business permit. And the rate usually is in the average 0.5 or 1%. And again, this tax cost will form part of the cost of the company and cannot be passed on to the consumer. Okay? Real property tax, these are the taxes imposed on real properties located within a particular jurisdiction, like your land, your buildings, your machines. On the average, it is 2% based on the assessed value of the property. So in summary, only income tax, local business tax, real property tax, and the customs duties will be shouldered by the company. Value-added tax is at the rate of 12, and the excise tax, various rates, can be passed on to the consumers, provided, again, the documentations are in order. Okay? Next question that was sent, what is the impact of the new tax reform law on the beverage industry? Well, the new tax reform law, which is RA 9631, otherwise known as the Tax Reform or Acceleration and Reduction Law, or the Trade Law, actually was signed into law by Duterte last December 19, 2017, and it took effect January 1, 2018. It is the first of the 5 series of tax laws that will be passed and implemented within the term of Duterte. Okay, so this one, this law took effect January 1, 2018. It amended a lot of the main provisions of the National Internal Revenue Code, from the taxation of individuals, inheritance tax from the rate of 20, it is now reduced to 6%. Donors tax or transfers for insufficient consideration or without consideration used to be taxed under the old law at 15%, now it is taxed at 6%. Okay? And the major provision which affected the beverage industry is actually excise tax. Excise tax has different names depending on the product. Okay? Excise tax is imposed on identified products only. So products that are subject to excise tax used to be imposed on luxury items. Or if the government wants to curb sale of sin products like cigarettes and liquor, they impose excise tax. And lately, they want also to curb obesity, they impose sugar tax on sugar sweetened beverages. Okay, for the excise tax on petroleum products, under the old law, it was not subject to excise tax. Under the new law, for every liter of diesel that we buy, excise tax component is 250 per liter. That's the reason why a lot of our diesel products increased this year. So who will be affected? Not only the manufacturing companies, even consumers like us. Why? It will increase the cost of transporting goods from the point of production to the point of sale. Our cost of travel will likewise increase, and even the cost to manufacture certain goods. Some electric companies are actually fed using diesel products. LPG or liquefied petroleum gas are sometimes used to manufacture certain products and used also in household, in everyday activities that we have. Okay, so diesel fuel will greatly impact the cost to manufacture beverage products. Okay? One major change brought about by the new law is also the sugar tax. So again, excise tax, depending on the product, is called by different names. So if it is imposed on cigarette or liquor, it is called sin taxes. Okay? These products are called sin products. To lower or limit the sale of these products, what the government did was to impose excise tax. If it is imposed on sugar sweetened beverage, it is called sugar tax. Again, the purpose again of the law, as they say, is to curb obesity. But we are questioning why they imposed it in the beverage when they could have imposed it in the sugar itself. So I don't know what is really the objective of the law, but I guess it's more to raise needed revenues for the government, not necessarily to curb obesity. Okay. For sugar tax, the rate currently is at 6 pesos per liter. So 1 liter of Coke, additional tax, 6 pesos. If the sweetener used is high fructose corn syrup, usually these are imported liquid syrup from corn, the rate that they will impose is 12 pesos. So why the difference between HFCS and the local sugar? Again, some sugar industry lobbyists were very strong. They wanted to ensure that the food beverage manufacturers will buy local sugar instead of imported sugar. That's the reason why they asked Congress to lower the rate of excise tax if the sweetener used is ordinary sugar. But if it is HFCS, which is actually an imported sugar, they requested Congress to impose a higher excise tax rate. That's the reason why Pepsi-Cola, Coca-Cola company has stopped importing HFCS as of 2017, because come 2018, January 1 of 2018, the rate that the government will impose as far as excise tax is concerned is 12 pesos per liter. Okay? Now, aside from the increase in the excise tax rate, which has an impact on the selling price of the goods, because this will be passed on to the consumers, one major thing which impacted the beverage industry is that excise tax actually being imposed on the goods manufactured should be paid prior to the release of the goods from the point of production. Meaning once it is produced, before you release it from the factory gate, you already need to pay the taxes. Can you imagine paying taxes in millions of pesos? And then eventually sell this product, we don't know even if we can sell the product. What if it expires? What if along the way, nasira yung product? So we don't even know what the benta, and yet we were already required to pay the taxes. And we cannot refund all this excise tax. Sometimes, nagkakaroon ng sales returns. If you're familiar with the term sales returns and allowances, if these are destroyed products, your customers will return it, but of course, we have already paid the excise taxes. So it's an impact on the cash flow of the company, not just on the cost, but on the cash flow. And as we all know, cash is key as far as business is concerned. We need all the cash we can get, and of course, there's a cost of money. Okay, so again, that's the major impact of the new law on the beverage industry. So these are the products subject to excise tax, and these are the products that are exempt from excise tax. Okay. Next question: what are the obstacles that could hinder us from complying with governmental regulations? Okay. One of the major things that the companies are now focusing is on compliance. During the old days, they usually take for granted compliance. In fact, now the multinational companies are putting up compliance teams just to focus on compliance, environmental law, taxation, government regulations, permits and licenses, because usually these activities were taken for granted. And it is only upon the imposition of penalties that they found out that they need to focus also on compliance. So what are the hindrances? Usually lack of knowledge. Because there is no single person that knows that what this particular government agency requires, like tax rules, FDA rules, local government rules, BOC. So now they are hiring lawyers who have specialization to focus mainly on compliance with government agencies. Now in tax, what we do is that we update ourselves regularly because tax practice is very dynamic. Weekly, there are new rules, new regulations, and that we need to make sure that we are updated as far as requirements are concerned. Okay. The fourth question is, what is your advice for aspiring entrepreneurs that are applying to the food industry? Okay, for Nestle, what they do is they keep on coming up with new products. We have already products that are already known in the market. We have Milo, cereals like Coco Crunch and those products. We have KitKat, Nido, Nescafe. Those are our products. But they keep on coming up with new products to make sure that they are able to cater to the needs of the market. So they identify market and then they come up with new products. Question 5, what are the ways you use to reduce the tax cost? The first question was how Nestle actually reduces tax. I simplified it this way because these are actually confidential matters. So there are ways. You can take advantage of the tax treaties. Sometimes payments to Nestle foreign corporations for dividends requires income tax of 20%. Some tax treaties, if you are able to identify which countries offers 10% withholding tax, we decide then to put up our head office in that particular country. So for local government, for local tax rules, sometimes when we set up companies, we identify whether we can locate our company in a peso zone, a Clark zone, a Subic zone, or we can enjoy DOI or Board of Investment Incentives. Why? Companies located in these zones or are DOI registered are subject only to tax at 5% in lieu of all taxes. Unlike a regular company like Nestle, we pay 30% income tax, 12% VAT, excise tax at various rates, Bureau of Customs, and then of course the local government. DOI, PESA, Subic, and Clark entities enjoy a lot of reduced tax rates. So we study the activity that they want, then we try also to study where they can be located, and we inform our company that if you locate this particular company in this place, or if you avail of DOI incentives, then we can actually avail reduced tax rates. And sometimes importations for these companies are likewise exempt. Okay. What else? For local business tax, Nestle is a very fixed asset heavy company because we have 5 plants in billions of pesos. So what we do is that I study also the composition of the fixed assets, and environmental assets are likewise exempt from local business. Small things, but if you add up all the exemptions, it will be, it will come up to millions. The benefit actually is huge when it comes to year-on-year savings.
Okay,
so I think that's the last
question. Last question.
Hook me up.